verse 4. Okay, Ephesians chapter 2 verse 4. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. Now in the bracket it will say, by grace you have been saved, and raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For you have been saved by grace through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Okay, so you know, this is a very familiar passage. Many times we read this passage, and when we come to verse 5, it says, even when we were dead in our trespasses, God made us alive with Christ. Verse 6, he raised us up with Christ. Verse 6 again says, he made us sit in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now, verse 7 says something. It says, that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. Now, you see, my friend, there are three things in the past tense. The three things in the past tense is that God made us alive with Christ, God raised us up with Christ, and God seated us with Christ. Okay, so there are three things in the past tense. Okay, whenever you are, say with me, God made me alive with Christ Jesus, God raised me up with Christ Jesus, God made me sit with Christ Jesus in heavenly places. So you see, these three things are already done. These three things are already done. What are the three things that are done? We were made alive in Christ. We were raised up with Christ. And now we are seated with Christ in heavenly places. Now these three things were done with a purpose. And the purpose is in verse 7. The verse 7 says that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. Now verse 8 says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. Now, the reason that you've been made alive. Okay, someone says my voice is getting low. Let me just. Okay, so the verse says the reason that we've been made alive, the reason we've been raised with Christ, and the reason that we are seated with Christ in heavenly places is that so that in the ages to come, we might experience the riches of his grace. Now, for many people, their encounter or the experience of coming to Christ and experiencing the forgiveness of sins, experiencing the embrace of the Father, might be the grand finale of what they call grace. Okay? So, yeah, as I was telling you yesterday, grace can have two meanings. For somebody who has a very inferior meaning of grace, they will say, when I pass with 39 marks and I get one mark extra, and you know, I get, instead of being called failed, I get called as passed. That is grace. That is a grace mark. But in truth, grace is actually the empowerment that not only makes you pass the exam, but it makes you be the topper in the class. It makes you be the topper in the university. So if you are not looking at the bigger picture of grace, if you're not looking at the eternal perspective of grace, if you're not looking at the Father's purpose of grace, then you will always concentrate and say, oh, I passed by one mark. I got one grace mark. I just crossed the borderline. And this is what is with people who are always saying, yes, I'm forgiven of my sins. Yes, God is happy with me. Yeah, that is true. But that is not where grace ends, okay? Grace has a purpose. And Bible says, when first grace encountered us, when first the person of Jesus encountered us, the reason grace has encountered us is so that he might show the exceeding riches of his grace to us. So say with me, I am yet to see the exceeding riches of his grace, and I will live, I will not die, I will experience the exceeding riches of his grace. Say with me once again. I am yet to see the exceeding riches of his grace. I will live and I will not die. I will experience the exceeding riches of his grace. Okay? So now to understand what might be the exceeding riches of his grace? Because grace is not something that comes to us when we are in need. Okay? Yeah. God provides our needs. God meets our needs. When we have messed up, God is there to make things straight for us. When we are in need, when we are in lack, God is there to provide for us. But then we need to look at the higher purposes of God. So let's come to Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3. I'm reading from verse 1. Here Paul says, For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ for you Gentiles, if indeed you have heard of the dispensation of grace of God, which was given to me, how that by revelation he made known to me the mystery, as I have briefly written already, by which when you heard that you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. Okay, now say with me, dispensation of grace. Dispensation of grace. And then say with me, the mystery of Christ. Now Paul is saying, in this dispensation of grace, I have been graced to reveal to you something which other people could not reveal to you. And Paul is saying, about this mystery, I have made known to you a little earlier in part, not in full. And now he's saying, verse 5, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of man, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to his holy apostles and prophets, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ to the gospel, of whom I became a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given to me by effective working of his power. Now in chapter 2, Paul explained that, you know, you are saved by grace. In chapter 2, Paul said, you are saved by grace. In chapter 2, Paul said, you have been made alive, you've been raised with Christ, you've been seated with Christ, so that you will experience the exceeding riches of his grace. Now in chapter 3 introduction, Paul is talking about the dispensation of grace or the age of grace, and he's saying, what was not told to you by other prophets, what was not made known to you by other men, now I have a grace to reveal this mystery to you in Christ. And he says, I have told you a little about it, but now I'm going to further explain to you. And he says, what is grace? Grace is an invitation for the Gentiles to come and become fellow heirs, to come and become joint heirs, to come and become a part of the body. Now, when we say like this, some people will think, I've been saved, I've become a Christian. But it doesn't end there, my friend. Just becoming a Christian doesn't end there, okay? Paul means something more, okay? For this reason, we are going to continue reading this today. Verse 8, to me who am less than the least of the saints, this grace was given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all to see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which was from the beginning of the ages, has been hidden in Christ, who created all things through Jesus Christ, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known to the church. Okay? Yesterday, I was speaking to you about the scope of grace. Today, I was telling you about not having an inferior view of grace, but having the more excellent view of grace, to have the larger picture of grace in our mind. So here is a large picture of grace in mind, my friend. Come to verse 9. It says, to make all see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the ages has been hidden in God, who created all things through Jesus Christ, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in heavenly places. Now listen to me, my friend. When we get saved, most of us, we are really happy that our sins are forgiven. We are really happy that we are going to a place called heaven. We are really happy that we have escaped a place of eternal torment called hell. That's good. Okay, that's good. But then Bible says that there is a mystery, and God wants you to understand what is the depth of this mystery, or what is the fellowship with this mystery. And Paul says that the manifold wisdom of God should be made known by the church to the principalities and powers. You see, my friend, why many people want to leave Earth is that they understand that they are not in control of the situations on this Earth. Many people want to leave Earth because they think if they live long, they will come short of finances, because your pension starts at 58 or 60, and after a few days, as the economy, as you know, as there is an inflation, your income keeps going down and then the expenses keep going high. So, you know, we have this view that, you know, living long is actually terrible. Living too long is actually terrible. We have this view that, you know, there is a particular age group in which we need to make a departure so that our departure is slow and sweet. This is what people believe, okay? But what is the Bible saying? Bible is saying, and why do we actually believe like that? We believe like that is because we think life is limited. We believe like that is because we think we are going to run out of our resources. We believe like that, you know, ask anybody who's in the age group of 35, 45, 50, they keep tracking what the government is telling about their PF. They keep tracking what the government is telling about their retirement benefits. And if you know, sometimes it's a good news, it's a jolly day for them. And sometimes if it's a bad news and they're a central government or a state government employee, you see their whole joy shrinks. The reason is because their trust is in those things. They do not trust the eternal purpose of God. And here it says, we are not to fear principalities and powers. That means what? We should not have a mentality of escaping out from the earth. Because many people believe that finally, when I have made a departure from the earth, there is nothing that can control my life. And at least I will be in a sweet, safe, and you know, a place where, you know, there is no tension, there is no sorrow, there is no pain. They want to think like that. But God's purpose is that He wants to make the principalities and the powers know what is the manifold wisdom that He is carrying, but He wants to make it known through the church. Okay? Tell yourself, put your one hand on your shoulder and tell yourself, I am the church. Tell yourself, I am the church. You are the church, my friend. You are the body of Christ. You are a member of His body. You are the bone of His bone, flesh of His flesh. And Bible is saying, God wants to reveal His manifold wisdom through you to the principalities and powers. So instead of here on earth looking for a way to escape, instead of here on earth looking to see how you will not get boggled down by the problems and the situations and circumstances, instead of being like this on earth, you need to have a shift of mindset, and you need to say, unless I begin to rule and reign, unless I have the larger picture in mind, unless I understand that grace is not only forgiveness, unless I understand grace is not only saying no condemnation, unless I understand grace is not only saying I have the Father's embrace, but unless I understand that grace is the empowerment of God, it is the Holy Spirit on the inside of me to rule and reign in this life to an extent that the principalities and powers will also say, oh my God, what is man that God is mindful of him, that He has created him in such a way that now He is exhibiting His manifold wisdom to man. You see, we all want to escape here, but God is saying, wait there, I want you to rule and reign, and I want the principalities, the powers, the dominion, and the authorities to see that through you, you are the vessel I have chosen, that through you, I will manifest my wisdom. Only when we understand this larger picture of grace, my friend, only when we understand this larger scope of grace, we will be willing to live out God's plan for our life. When we do not understand this, then we think, you know, we are, whenever we encounter something, we are going to begin to think that, oh my God, let me just get over this. Let me just do a little spiritual warfare. Once I'm done with this, I just wish there is no other problem that is going to come in my life. I just wish there is no other thing that, you know, abnormal, uncomfortable that I'm going to face in life. I just wish my health is good, my bank balance is good, and I just wish that it is going to be a cakewalk for the rest of my life. You know, we go into that surviving mentality. We go into that mentality where we are not looking to thrive in life, but we go into a mentality where we are going to just survive in life. And grace is an invitation open to anyone, my friend. It is open to anyone to come and receive this invitation and experience the high life that God wants to give them. Let me give you an example. Like I was telling yesterday, okay, you want to buy a phone, and probably you're somebody who has a lot of work on phone. So, you know, ultimately you decided to buy an Apple, okay? Probably Apple iPhone 11. I don't know where's the version now, which one is the latest, but probably iPhone 11 Pro you decided to buy. Now, this phone happens to have 8 gig RAM, and then, you know, it is costing 1 lakh rupees. So somebody told you, why do you want to spend so much, okay? Just buy a normal Redmi phone, just buy a Mi phone. In 30, 40,000, you will get 8 GB, and, you know, just do your work. And suddenly you say to yourself, no, my work is very important. For me, the camera clarity is important. For me, the pictures I capture is important. For me, the video I make is important. For me, the apps are important. For me, the voice clarity in the phone is important. So let me go and do one thing. Let me go and buy this Apple phone. So you go to buy this Apple phone. When you are buying the Apple phone, one of the most important things you do, whether you buy online or you buy in the shop, is that when you are shelling out that big money, 1 lakh rupees for a phone, you're going to make sure that you understand what is the warranty, what is the guarantee on the phone, right? You're going to make sure you understand that. And once you get your iPhone and you come back home and you start using the phone, imagine the first or the second day without doing anything wrong from your side, okay? The phone starts behaving in a faulty way. You will go to the shop, and if the shopkeeper shows a lax attitude, or if you know people at the service center or people at the showroom show a bad attitude, or they show as if they're not concerned that your phone went bad, then immediately you're going to say, hey man, I gave 1 lakh rupees for this phone. I could have got 8 gig of RAM. Even in a phone that is 20 or 30,000, I could have taken Oppo or Mi. But why did I buy Apple, a trusted brand? Because, you know, I needed this quality. I needed this phone to function without, any errors. And, you know, after paying 1 lakh rupees, if I'm not getting service, if I'm getting this trouble, I don't think so. You know, this is the kind of service or this is the kind of product I deserve. You're going to say like this, my friend. Why? Because you shelled out 1 lakh rupees and you know that the validity of that warranty is there for 1 year, but within 2 days, you are beginning to have a problem. And many times when we preach the gospel to people and we say, God wants you to rule and reign in this life. God wants you to thrive in this life. God wants you not only to be healed, but God wants you to heal others. God not only wants you to provide for your need, but God wants you to be a blessing to others. What many people do is they embrace the first part. And they think, I am not the one eligible for the second part. Why? Because I have not been so diligent. You know, my sins have been great. Or, you know, my walk has not been that great. But when we come to God, we need to understand that God sees it that God sees through this lens. God says, I have not redeemed you by a corruptible gold. I have not redeemed you by a corruptible value. God says, I have redeemed you by incorruptible value. I have redeemed you by the blood of your son Jesus. And God says, if you understand this, then no matter where you are in your journey with God, you want to lay hold of this inheritance God has for you. You want to lay hold of this purpose God has for you. You want to lay hold of this plan God has for you. And you want to pursue it fully. Because, you know, every time somebody tells you, you're weak, you're ineligible, every time, you know, you go into guilt, condemnation, all you do is you don't count yourself by corruptible things. You don't value yourself by corruptible situations. You don't value yourself by what has happened to you. But you see the blood of the Lamb. You see the blood of the Lamb and you say, no, I've been made alive. I've been raised with Christ. I've been seated with Christ. And I am seated with Christ in the heavenly places, so that on earth, I will experience the riches of his grace. So that I will experience the riches of his grace in such an extent on earth that even the principalities and the powers need to be astonished that God has chosen me to be a vessel through whom he is dispensing heaven onto earth. Right now we think, you know, the angels are great bodies, but God is saying, I want to shock the angels by what I do through my sons and daughters on the earth. But the challenge is this: sons and daughters on the earth are in awe of the angels, but God is saying, my purpose, my grace is for you to be a manifestation of the riches of my glory. My purpose, my grace is so that I can exhibit my manifold wisdom through you. Wherever you are, my friend, let's start praying. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for everyone under the influence of my voice, Father. It is not a call of man, Father, that will change them, but it has been your heart cry from the beginning of creation that you wanted your sons and daughters to rule and reign on this earth. You wanted your sons and daughters to be fruitful, to multiply, to subdue, to be excellent, and to expand. You gave your son Jesus so that through the body, through the blood of Jesus, we will embrace your eternal plan and purpose on this earth. Through his blood and through his body, we will understand that we do not have a value that can be counted in terms of money or gold, but we have a value that is incorruptible because we have been redeemed by the incorruptible blood of the Lamb. And so, Father, we understand that because this blood is incorruptible, this blood always speaks a better thing. This blood always speaks a better promise. This blood always speaks a better word into our situations and circumstances. I pray for everyone over this call right now. I pray for everyone over this call right now. I pray you receive the gift of God. You receive the gift of his grace to become a vessel that will display his honor, his glory, and his riches on this earth. I pray that you receive the gift of God, that you become a vessel, that you experience his divine healing, and you become a dispensation center of his healing to everyone around you. I pray that you receive the gift of God, that you receive the living waters in abundance, and from your overflow, many who are thirsty will be satisfied. I pray that you receive the gift of God, that you receive the living bread, and then you set a table for others to receive this living bread from your table. I pray that you receive the gift of God, that you will thrive in this life, no more survival, but you will thrive in this life. I see God giving acceleration to few people in their call today. I see God giving acceleration to few people regarding their business, regarding their job, regarding their ministry. God says morality is good, but God says when you add my purposes to your morality, that's when you will see acceleration in your life. God says you need to repent, you need to repent, you need to repent, you need to reshift, you need to rechange, you need to keep changing your thinking till you understand that my purpose for you is to be the head and not the tail. Till you understand that my purpose for you is to be on the top and not at the bottom. Till you understand that my purpose for you is to be above only and never below. And God says, you are my sons and daughters. In this time, in this generation, in this season, I'm raising up sons and daughters who are saying no to chaos, who are saying no to worry, who are saying no to greed, who are saying no to the things of the world, because their focus is on the glorified Christ. Their focus is on being transformed. Their focus is on receiving instruction. Their focus is on divine alignment. And God says, from this point of rest, God says, from this point of rest, I am birthing a new season in your life. I am birthing a new season in your life. There will be no more turmoil. There will be no more turmoil. There will be no more sweat. There will be no more mishaps. There will be no more accidents. There will be no more bad news in your life. But God says, in this new season, wait for my instruction. God says, the most beautiful thing that you can do in prayer or worship, as part of your prayer or worship, is to wait for my instruction, is to wait on me. Because blessed are those who receive my instruction. There is divine acceleration in my instruction. You will overtake the chariots of this world through my instruction. Father, I pray for every heart. I bless every heart today on this call. I pray for your peace. I pray for your goodness. I pray for your grace. I pray, Father, they will experience the exceeding riches of your grace, Father. I pray the eyes of understanding will be enlightened to see what is the exceeding riches of your grace, to see how you have a plan, a purpose in your mind that these people will not be under the dominion of principalities or powers, but your sons and daughters will control the principalities and powers by the meditation of their heart, by the words of their mouth, and they will become the ecclesia. They will become the governing body. They will become the people who will manifest heaven on earth. I thank you, Father. I bless you, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen, amen, amen.